Getting ready to buy or sell a home? Do you want to help support pro-life organizations? Then you need Real Estate for Life. Get a top-notch real estate agent and support pro-life causes. Go to realestateforlife.org to learn more.
May the holy names of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph be blessed now and forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Celebrate in this penitential time the third class feast of a great saint, Saint Antoninus of Florence. The celebrated Saint Antoninus was Archbishop of Florence. He was born, we wind back the clock to 1389 in the 14th century in the city of the name Florence. He was the only son of very pious parents. And hence he was educated then with great solitude. In baptism he received the name Anthony, but on account of the smallness of his stature, he was called Antoninus, or Little Anthony. This is what this means, Little Anthony. In childhood he was so pious that he was even given the title of Little Saint. He never left the house except to go to school or to church. In the church, he was always found in the position of kneeling, generally before the statue of the Blessed Virgin Mary, to whom he loved very much, and to whom he ascribed the grace he received from God to lead a holy and pure life. He desired then early to enter the order of the preachers, the order of the Dominicans. But the prior in charge, head of the house, on account of his youth and his great delicacy of health, hesitated then to admit him. Yet he did not wish to hurt him by the refusal. He gave him a great challenge then. He told him that when he had learned by heart the ecclesiastical law, which he obviously thought impossible for this small child, when he had studied by heart the ecclesiastical law, which was studied at that time, he should present himself again, and then he would be admitted. A year elapsed. Antoninus returned, Little Anthony, saying that he had studied his task and he hoped to receive the habit. The father provincial, the prior, could hardly credit this assertion or the affirmation of Antoninus, and he then examined him and found that he indeed had spoken the truth, and he knew the whole canonical law by heart. And this was a convincing proof not only of the ability of the youth, but also of his divine vocation. Then he was gladly received into the order. Antoninus soon became the most perfect model of virtue. He was always the first and the last in the choir, and passed the greater part of the night in prayer and devout reading. Only when sick did he partake in meat. His bed was a board, and not until he was far advanced in years did he sleep upon a straw mattress. He never divested himself of his garment of hair cloth, penance belt, and although his constitution was weak and sickly, he never relaxed his austerity towards himself, not even when he became the archbishop. While he was very young, he was appointed on account of his great ability and his great virtues, the prior of the monasteries, and later he presided over the Roman and Neapolitan provinces as provincial, and then he was chosen by the Holy Father then as the Archbishop of Florence. He was deeply grieved when he heard the news that he had been selected for this position, and seeking to flee, he left for Siena. He used all possible means to avoid this dignity, but he was obliged to obey as the Pope threatened him with excommunication. Hence, it was with weeping eyes that he received the episcopal consecration, praying to God thus, "Lord, it is known to thee how unwillingly I take this burden upon myself. As I am, however, compelled to obey thy vicar, I pray thee to rule me also, that I may conform my life to thy holy will and do all that thou demands of me." He commenced then his new functions by the regulation of his residence, which wore the appearance then now of a cloister than rather than a palace of a bishop. His household consisted of 8 persons to whom he gave large salaries, while he himself lived no better than he had done in the convent. No mendicant or poor person was sent from his door without alms. He also founded an institution where those might receive aid who were ashamed even to beg. His private income he used for the needy, and he said it did not belong to him, but it belonged to the poor. This is the magnificence of this saint today. Many prevailing abuses among existed at that time, such as playing dice, he abolished altogether. He lent a most patient ear to the complaints and the demands of those under him. Everyone had access to him, and no one left him untouched by his holiness. His zeal to keep his flock constant in their faith was truly, we say this word, heroic. He was one day exhorted to relax somewhat in his labors, lest his health should suffer. And he said, "Prelates of the church," replied he, "must not think of themselves, but of the welfare of those in their charge, their flock." The Almighty also bestowed upon him the gift of prophecy, and also the power to restore the sick, and to cleanse men and dwellings from evil spirits. To a surgeon who one day complained to him that his house was greatly disturbed by an evil spirit, the saint replied that certain superstitious books which he kept was the cause of it, and advised him to burn it. This was done, and the disturbance ceased. Being at length exhausted from work, he was seized with a slow fever in the 70th year of his age. Feeling his end was approaching, he divided all he had among the poor, so that when the expenses of his funeral were paid, 4 ducats were all that was left. Having most devoutly received the holy sacraments, he cried suddenly aloud, "To serve God is to reign." Some of the canons read a part of the daily prayers of the church, and the saint responded well as he could. At length, kissing and pressing the image of Jesus Christ crucified most fervently to his breast, he expired on the night of the Ascension Day in the year of our Lord, 1459. What can we learn then of this great saint today, this Dominican? Do not be a creature of the world and belong to the prince of the world, the prince of darkness. Be in the world, but not of the world. Be a child living in light. Be a child of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. Stay in the light of grace and put sin to flight. Look at the example in the life of this great little Antony today. One day, walking through the city, he saw many angels upon a roof of a poor little house. Going into it, he found a respectable widow with 3 daughters, who lived by the labor of their hands, who earned scarcely enough to clothe themselves decently, and who had nothing to eat. The saint not only gave them liberal alms, but thereafter came frequently to their relief. It happened, however, that after a considerable time, when passing the same house later, instead of holy angels, this little Antony saw devils on the roof who seemed to enjoy themselves greatly. What did he do? He went into the house and saw the mother and the daughters now not occupied with good pious and holy works, but with visitors and frivolous amusements. He likewise found various books which served to entertain them. The saint from this easily concluded what the apparition signified. He reprimanded them severely, and admonishing them to return to their former industry, was in future more careful in distributing his charities. This is the message today: to invoke the Blessed Virgin Mary and to watch over yourselves and your households and to be holy. Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. Why not take up those watching today, if you have not consecrated your houses and made them a refuge to the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary, then in the difficult times to come, people will be flocking to your house. Why? Because it will be the refuge of Jesus and Mary. Why not do this beautiful act and pray every day in honor of the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary? So remember, you are in the world, be not of the world. Be not a child of the devil, but be a child of our Lord Jesus Christ and the Blessed Virgin Mary, so that you can one day see them when you walk, God willing, through the gates of paradise. Amen. May the holy names of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph be blessed now and forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.